New plans for what will become one of the tallest buildings in the state, grading local restaurants based on the health code, and procedures for what happens when police officers commit domestic abuse. This is Council Rewind, and I'm Dustin Weiss. At 44 stories and a height of 507 feet, the Couture high-rise is set to become the fourth tallest building in the city. Featuring a mix of luxury apartments and commercial space and a price tag of $122 million, the Couture will do more than reshape the city's skyline. Built around a transit concourse incorporating the city's new streetcar, the building rethinks the way that architecture interacts with the city around it. And on April 11th, the Zoning Neighborhoods and Development Committee got its first look at detailed plans for the project.
And then this is the ground level. So the ground level consists of three major components. Parking along the west side of the site, you can see on the plan. Dividing the parking and the retail spaces on the east and the corner, anchoring the corners, is the transit concourse. You can see the transit concourse runs north-south, connecting essentially Clybourne and Michigan, both for pedestrians, the streetcar, buses, as well as on the anchoring the corners of Clybourne and Lincoln Memorial, as well as Michigan Lincoln Memorial, are the retail spaces as well as lobby spaces for the residential. The second level plan, which is where the connections to O'Donnell Park via pedestrian bridge and east to the Gateway Lakefront Gateway Plaza Park, occur on the second level, as well as retail spaces, and we can discuss any of this in more detail, but also access from the pedestrian plaza on the ground level through a stair, a pedestrian stair, as well as elevator located in this pedestrian hub. The rooftop of the plinth, this is the plan of the plinth, incorporates the top roof deck of the parking structure, a publicly accessible park over the transit concourse, as well as a restaurant, retail space on the tower plinth and over the existing retail space. The fourth floor is actually where the units for the Couture Tower start. There'll be an amenity deck for the residents on the fourth floor rooftop of the retail space. And then just some three-dimensional views, again, just to give more clarity to a fairly complex project. So here you can see this is a bird's eye view looking northwest. Lincoln Memorial is running along that corner here. Michigan to the north of the property is there on the rendering, and then Clybourne on the south. So you can see the slate gray on the west side of the property, that's the parking structure. Dividing the parking structure and the retail is the transit concourse. And that's approximately 40 foot tall space. Second level is the pedestrian concourse. You can see the connections to O'Donnell Park and the Lakefront Gateway Park over Lincoln Memorial. Connections over the transit center, transit concourse to the parking structure. And then the rooftop deck, you can see there, there will be retail on the east side of the property facing Lincoln Memorial Drive and addressing the lakefront. And the rooftop of the retail space on the plinth. And then the rest of the tower. And some renderings showing the building. This is a view looking southwest, as if you're standing in the Kiley Gardens of the Art Museum. This is a view looking east or southwest or southeast along Michigan. some of the changes that we made in our recent discussions with the neighboring property to the west, we did remove a section of the parking structure to create a much bigger gap between the 833 building and the west side of the Couture plinth. And you can see we've created, there will be bike parking storage space on the ground level, as well as a little pocket park space. And then we did drop the entire height of the plinth about 1.5 feet, again, to accommodate for the 833's fourth floor where their office starts. Rendering looking south through the transit concourse, you can see here the transit concourse does accommodate buses, the streetcar, bicycles, pedestrians, obviously, and is an open air space that runs north-south through the site. Corner of Lincoln Memorial and Michigan. Again, we wanted to address that corner, especially given the art museum across the street, Discovery World, as well as the millions of people that will be walking by the site to get to Summerfest and the lakefront itself. The southeast corner of the property, you can see two levels of retail. So here we're flying over the art museum, lakefront. We've modeled in the future Lakefront Gateway Plaza Park on the foreground. Here we're flying over Clybourne and the intersection of Lincoln Memorial. You can see how the retail, park, parking, and plaza spaces interlock. Here we're flying over the park space on the rooftop. You can see the plaza on the northeast corner of the site, and then looking at the transit concourse. Here we'll fly into the concourse. And then coming across the O'Donnell Park pedestrian bridge, and just a view of the top of the tower here.
Wow.
That's it.
The absolutely love the building.
Thank you.
Absolutely love it.
And the bridge, is that just a stand-in design, or is that something that would be funded through this, or that's something that we need to get?
The bridge crossing Lincoln Memorial will be funded through the park funds.
So all you're doing is making sure you have a point of connection there.
When,
depending on that schedule, it could be that this building goes up without the bridge, and you'll wait for that project to then happen. Is it definitely linked, timing wise?
I can't speak to the timing of the bridges, but okay. Certainly we'd love to see it all occur at once.
How much space is dedicated to retail, and how much space is dedicated to the restaurant?
We have approximately 40,000 square feet of retail space.
Okay.
The restaurant level, I believe we're about 12,000 square feet.
I think it's a little less than that.
A little less.
Yeah. Okay. Any proposals yet, Rick?
Still working on it.
Okay. And the transit concourse, how long is that in the actual Couture building part?
The building? It runs the entire length of the site. I'm trying to remember the exact dimensions.
I think it's close to 300 feet.
About 300. Okay.
And is it one pickup spot? One pickup spot?
Correct. Yeah, we're planning a pickup spot right next to where the stairs go up to the second level pedestrian hub.
We also have junior one bedrooms in this particular project, which we're really proud of, because I think they're price point driven. So I think people will really appreciate the fact that we're pushing some units right there that are 570 square feet, mm-hmm. and they may function as a studio from a sizing standpoint, but the reality is we've created a pocket door system that actually allows for the bedroom to close off. So it almost functions as a one bedroom in a square footage that's typically a studio. So we're really proud of that competitive piece, and that'll be less than $2,000 a month. So.
Mr. Chair.
Finished all.
Thank you.
Alderman
Ray. Yeah.
Mr. Bear, how many units again?
312 units.
And ideally, who is the ideal tenant for this development?
The ideal tenant is either a young professional or a empty nester looking to be in the coolest location in the city.
Signature building for the city from multiple avenues. I think, you know, this is going to be the ideal retail location. This is going to be the ideal renting location. Obviously, the fact that you've incorporated the transit component here, this is going to be the place. And I think that you knew that. You have an ideal location, and, you know, to you for taking on and waiting this out here patiently. I know that, you know, you were probably, it's like being in the on-deck circle forever when they call a timeout in the middle of a baseball game, which they don't do, and waiting to take your swings. But you did hit this out of the park, and congratulations on that.
Plans for the Couture were approved on a unanimous vote, and work is expected to begin by year's end. The notion of shaming restaurants that fail to adhere to the health code and celebrating those with a stellar record has proven a powerful motivator in other cities. So Alderman Michael Murphy asked if we couldn't issue letter grades to local eateries here in Milwaukee. And on April 7th, the health department presented their plans for the project to the Public Safety Committee.
As we all know, Milwaukee is now one of the top cities in the United States for foodies. It's a destination location based on all the incredibly wonderful restaurants that have opened in the last 10 to 15 years in Milwaukee. And I think every one of us are very proud of the accomplishments of all the great restaurant operators in our own respective districts, but certainly throughout the city. And one of the things that I felt very strongly about is, in many cities I have an opportunity to have been through, they have a grading system. And I'm sure many of you have seen them, whether you've been in New York, San Francisco, Chicago, where you see a grade on the window where the health department places a grade either of A to F in terms of the food health inspection report. They've been around for a number of years, but the city of Milwaukee has not pursued that. Several years ago, though, I did pursue wanting to have that information on our health department reports published in our own website, so citizens certainly could go and look to the website, look at the health department reports. That was prior to Yelp. I wish I would have come up with the idea of Yelp, but I didn't. But the reality is we want to further on that mission. And why do I think it's important is I think consumers can help drive and improve quality safety. As you know, with shrinking budgets, we have more and more work, however, in allowing the consumer to play an active role in helping improve the food quality is based on this grading system. I believe we've come up with a unique system which is quite substantially better than other cities in our country because we have really listened to the food industry. We've looked at the best practices across the United States and Canada to see where it's been effective in making a difference. I can tell you where restaurant owners are maybe positively impressed by it is that when you have a good positive rating, you can see increased sales by up to 10% in addition to what you currently have. So there's a carrot and a stick approach to this methodology. And I also would like to acknowledge the strong support we receive from our partners at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. Our legislative director downstairs, one of our legislative directors, Adam, was very helpful in introducing me to the executive MBA program at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. As part of their projects, the students at the MBA program took on the responsibilities of coming up with the computer program, looking at our data, and drafting that, and allowing that to be used by our health department in a collaborative partnership. We couldn't have accomplished that without them. That put in a substantial amount of time and hours and savings of tax dollars, money, all free of charge, based on the great partnership we have at one of our premier UWM educational institutions. I'd also like to acknowledge the health department, who's been working with me on this issue for some time.
There are 48 million individuals sickened each year in the U.S. 128,000 are hospitalized, and there's 3,000 deaths, and that's related to foodborne illness. Restaurants pose two times the amount of risk of outbreaks as homes do. The cost per illness in the U.S. is about $77.7 billion. It's an average cost of $1,628 per case. And for the city of Milwaukee, that is a cost of $108 to $162 million. If there is a 10% decrease in foodborne illness, would save the city over $10,000.
$10 million
per year. The environment that we're working with, in 2015, Americans spent more dining out than buying groceries for the first time ever. That's millennial driven. In 2014, Milwaukee was named one of the top 11 foodie cities, as Alderman Murphy had mentioned. And there's increasing use of technology to reach health goals. So the food grading system, it would be a point system, and that's based off of criteria that the FDA have identified. So the FDA identifies a violation as either a priority foundation, or a core item. Traditionally, people would think of those as critical and non-critical. The priority violation is a violation that this contributes directly to the elimination, prevention, or reduction to an acceptable level hazards associated with foodborne illness or injury, and there's no other provision that more directly controls this hazard. And we identified that that would be worth a 5 points. The priority foundation, that is something that supports, facilitates, or enables one or more of the priority items, and that would be a 3 point deduction. And the core item is one that usually relates to general sanitation, operational controls, sanitation standard operating procedures, facilities or structures, equipment design, or general maintenance, and that would be 2 points. This is what the grading algorithm would look like in the background. This is what the MBA students have developed, and it is where the violations would be put in the computer system, and it would come out with a score in the end. The key elements, it's a 100-point based system. There'd be, as I said, 2, 3, or 5 point violations. Points may be earned back during a reinspection, which is a really important piece of this program. We want to be able to reward operators or show improvement. And one thing we wanted to identify is that points cannot be earned back for repeat violations, and that is because we want to have consistent change over time. We want these practices to maintain. So as I was talking about, the points can be earned back. So it's listed here as for the first reinspection, you can earn points back either 3 points for priority, 1.8 for a priority foundation, or 1.2 for the core. And it goes down by the second and then the third reinspection, because we want to really encourage operators to make those changes, those corrections, by the first reinspection. And another thing we learned from other jurisdictions is having a weighted system is one of the most successful ways to do this. And so the first year we would only have one inspection in the system, so it would be worth 100 points, and then the second, or 100%, and then the second year it would be a 50% for this current inspection and the previous one. And then once you have three inspections in the system, they'd be weighted, such as the most current would be 50%, then the previous would be 35%, and then the third would be 15% for a 100% score. And the purpose for that is so that not so much is weighted on the one inspection. We want to be able to see, based off of three inspections, how the performance is. And the proposed model is a three-tiered system. So out of the 100 points, a passing score would be a score of 79 to 100%. A borderline score would be 70 to 78, and the closure would be under 70. And then how could the results be displayed, such as a placard? This is something that we're still going to be doing community outreach and education and getting feedback. These are just two examples of what a placard could look like, whether it be a score or just be a color. We intend on putting the QR code on the placards, which is where someone could scan from their phone, and that would link them to the inspection report so they could see that.
Following a summer test run, the grading system will be rolled out early next year. On March 11th, a 47-year-old Milwaukee police officer shot and killed his estranged wife before turning the gun on himself. In the weeks since this heinous, tragic crime, questions have emerged about how MPD handles such cases and what's being done to update these policies. The Public Safety Committee examined the issue on April 7th.
In fact, recent headlines and news stories, I'm sure we are all aware of, involved a murder-suicide involving an MPD officer, which is part of the emphasis for us bringing this file here today, is for us to have a transparent conversation about what the standard procedure is within Milwaukee's Police Department as it relates to their dealing with and investigating domestic violence when it is an officer involved situation, to look at that procedure and to, you know, each time incidences occur, it gives an opportunity for us to review policy and an opportunity for us to see how it can be improved upon. But I think first we must have the discussion about where we are, and then I think we can have a discussion about where we might need to be going.
Tragic incident that the Alderwoman referred to. Our domestic violence policy was already under review and revision. Without speaking too much about that situation, it rocked the police department. Obviously, I had personal connections to some people involved. I was there, and it definitely refocused some things for me personally and for some others on the department. When the Risk Management Bureau was formed, was in its current formation in 2013, I was newly promoted and sent to the police academy as a training director. My deputy director, who's in the room right now, Captain Amy Obregon, and I, luckily we were, fortunately, we were on the same page when it came to department training. And I'm glad I personally have a chance to speak about this issue because we decided to proactively address this particular problem. First full training year we were there, we had training on employee-involved domestic violence, where we issued the state policy to our members. The second training year that we were there, we had domestic violence scenarios, early intervention training, and looking for warning signs for situations like this and other situations as well. So we proactively approached this problem. And it has not been a scientific study, but we have had results. We have seen results. In 2012, our Internal Affairs Division investigated 9 incidents. In 2013, they investigated 5 incidents. In 2014, at the end of which year we began our interventions, they investigated 8 incidents. The next 2 full years, 2015 and 2016, we saw 3 and 2 incidents respectively. 2015, we saw 3. 2016, we saw 2. Well, these are incidents that are reported to the police department. We can't account for incidents that are not reported to us or incidents that are reported to advocacy agencies. But it appears our intervention has had some impact.
And it is a known fact because I've had several people from the community reach out and some officers reach out and say this was something that has been known to the department and it did not reach Fire and Police Commission. So it should have been under review a long time ago before this incident escalated to this degree. And so I'm really concerned about the processes and how we are allowing that. So going back to what I said with being a separate fraternity type, because I'm military, so I understand that, you know, police have a separate underlined way of life, and it's a brotherhood, and just like firefighters, just like military, and so it doesn't necessarily get the level of discipline that it should oftentimes, which is where we see this now. And so I'm trying to really understand why this wasn't brought to, you know, to the forefront before now.
Would it be fair to say that policing or individuals engaged in that kind of work sometimes are perhaps a little reluctant to take advantage of counseling or I don't say this in a negative way, but sometimes that may appear like it's less macho, if you will, or, you know, I have the utmost respect for police officers, believe me when I say that. But do you feel that maybe that plays a role sometimes? They don't want to admit that I may need help on something.
Absolutely. You're 100% on the right track with that. It has been a problem in our profession that reaching out has been perceived to result in a stigma. But we have, again, proactively worked to reduce that stigma. And the best way to do that is by continuously talking about it.
Do family members have an avenue to report it without calling the police? That would somehow get to the right people at the police department?
They do. Family members can report to.
And how are they informed about these avenues if it isn't through the police officer?
It would have to be through public awareness. We can ask our members to inform their family members, but we can't force them. We mention things like this at our friends and family night for new recruit officers. When it comes to reaching out to family members for avenues that they can take, that is an aspect of certain model policies. There are some practical issues to it, however, that make it unfeasible to say that you can do that 100% of the time. I mean, I can't go to a member's house and talk to their family members about this.
As also a part of the preparation for this file, I requested from LRB on what other cities are doing and what some best practices and national models are. They did provide me with a memo that I would like to make a part of the record of some other cities and what they have. None of those cities had as brief, as short, and as non-comprehensive an SOP as we here at the city of Milwaukee have. So it is great to hear that it is under review and that they do intend, and I'm glad to hear that they're working with the advocates. I think that is an important component to make sure that it is better. Inspector, I would like to hear from you what an expected timeline for that improved SOP is.
My boss and I was about to call her inspector. Assistant Chief Yerkes and I have been passing around that portion, which I personally am working on. I expect that when she returns from vacation, it will be done, that portion. After that, there's some administrative things like sending it to the FBC, sending it to the union. I won't make a promise that I can't keep. But very soon, that policy will be completed. Because Captain Obregon has pretty much rewritten the entire policy for our standard response. And I told her that I'm going to be expanding the member involved section.
We will hold this at your request and revisit it down the road. But again, I would publicly emphasize that some of this needs to fall directly in the lap of the Fire and Police Commission. They have responsibilities towards policies and procedures for the department. We can suggest and urge, but they have the authority to move forward.
The communication was held open to ensure that the committee receives an update when new policies are enacted. And that's a look back at some of the important issues from the most recent Common Council cycle. For the City Channel and Council Rewind, I'm Dustin Weiss.